When you think of a painting, what comes to mind? A sweeping landscape with patches of light and shadow? A beguiling portrait where the eyes seem to follow you? Whatever it is, danger probably isn't at the top of the list. But for centuries, being a painter or even a paint producer was a serious health hazard. Because sometimes, the key to making these colors pop is poison. Let me paint you a picture of the most toxic pigments from the past. Let's start with white. One of the oldest and most common ways to make a white paint was to use good old-fashioned lead. Lead has been a popular pigment since BCE times because when it's combined with carbon and oxygen, it makes a bright white that lasts a long time. It's been used in cosmetics as well as paints for everything from art to architecture. And I'm sure I'm not the first one to inform you that lead is, highly toxic. Unless I am, in which case, you're welcome. But while it's common knowledge that lead is poisonous, what we don't talk about as much is exactly why that is. Lead messes with your body by booting out calcium ions in various calcium-based things, including bone formation and calcium ion channels. These are special proteins in the outer cell surface that help bring stuff into or out of a cell. So you can imagine how anything that messes with calcium and breaks these channels would have a whole range of nasty side effects. The physical symptoms of lead poisoning include kidney problems, hypertension, and reproductive issues. And lead is particularly bad for your brain. Even at low levels, lead exposure is linked to increased rates of learning disabilities. At high levels, lead poisoning can cause delirium, hyperirritability, convulsions, and coma. Also, death, so not great. Which is why, these days, painters use zinc oxide or titanium dioxide to create those bright whites without the lead poisoning. Next up is another historically popular pigment with staggeringly bad health effects, cinnabar. Cinnabar has been a go-to red for millennia. This vermilion mineral is made of two ingredients, mercury and sulfur. And like lead white, cinnabar has also been used as a cosmetic with similarly toxic results. People in ancient Greece and Rome were pretty into it, but what's wild is that even the Romans who used it knew that cinnabar was toxic. So maybe it won't come as a surprise that mining cinnabar was mostly done by enslaved people and was considered a de facto death sentence. Mercury sulfide, aka cinnabar red, is a form of mercury salt, which is not for eating. Mercury salts can poison you if you ingest them, breathe them in, or even just touch them. When it gets into your body, mercury inhibits certain enzymes, and it can affect pretty much every part of the body. It messes with your immune system, damages your kidneys, and inhibits muscle function. Like lead, mercury is bad for your brain too. It can cause tremors, memory loss, and behavior changes, and sometimes hallucinations. So if you're trying to find the perfect shade to paint a sunset or a still life of a fruit basket, maybe go with one that has less mercury in it. I would anyway. And if that sunset is going to include orange, another color to stay away from is minium orange, because as it turns out, this particular orangey pigment is made of lead tetroxide. Minium orange was popular for illuminated medieval manuscripts, and it was made by taking lead white and basically cooking it, creating a nice orange hue. And since it's also lead-based, all the symptoms and side effects are the same as they were for lead white. Next up is school bus yellow. That's not just a descriptor, that's the actual name of a specific paint. More specifically, it's called National School Bus Glossy Yellow. This paint was first picked out for school buses in the 1930s because it's distinctive and eye-catching, which would hopefully mean that drivers would take extra precautions around them. But it turns out that they should probably have been more worried about the safety of the bus painters, since school bus yellow is super toxic. The original formula for school bus yellow used chromium in the form of lead chromate as its pigment, so you get a double dose of poison. We've already covered why lead is bad, so we'll just focus on the chromium. And this paint in particular is so nasty because of the kind of chromium in it, hexavalent chromium. See, chromium atoms can have different charges based on how many open spaces they have in their electron fields, which is called their valency. Hexavalent chromium has a charge of 6+, meaning it has 6 fewer electrons than is stable, and it is desperate to fill those spots up with more electrons. So hexavalent chromium will straight up steal electrons from the molecules in your cells, causing massive damage wherever it goes. As it steals electrons and fills those open spaces, it'll turn into trivalent chromium, which still has three open spots, but it's way more stable and won't go out of its way to steal them from your cells. And as it turns out, that trivalent chromium might actually be good for you. There's some studies that suggest that trivalent chromium might help insulin work better, and that it's a decent antioxidant, although that research is still in its early days. But if trivalent chromium does prove to be beneficial, that doesn't change how very toxic the hexavalent kind is. And it's definitely nasty. Inhaling particles of hexavalent chromium paint can cause ulcers in your nose, bronchitis, pneumonia, and lung function issues. Once this lead chromate is in the bloodstream, it causes kidney and liver damage, as well as damage to your blood cells. Chronic exposure also correlates with development of loads of different cancers, because it can mess with your DNA and lead to mutations. And as one final bonus, it's neurotoxic, which is why these days school buses tend to be painted with specialized automotive paints that are acrylic-based and chromium-free.
Thanks to Delete Me for supporting this SciShow video. Delete Me works to keep your personal information personal. They remove your info from public search results, giving you back more control over who you share it with. They'll even remove your personal information continuously throughout the year. And it adds up. In a single year, Delete Me's privacy experts remove clients from hundreds of data brokers. Those are corporations that collect personally identifiable information into profiles. They'll include things like social security numbers, birthdays, past and recent addresses, information about your relatives, stuff most people want to keep private. To protect that info, you can go to joindeleteme.com/scishow and use the promo code SciShow at checkout. You'll get 20% off Delete Me US consumer plans.
Buses and paintings aren't the only place to find poison pigments. You can find our next one in Victorian wallpaper. This shade of green is called Scheele's green, and it's one of the most famous toxic colors out there. It was made by combining copper with arsenic. We have Carl Wilhelm Scheele to thank for this eponymous green, which became a mainstay in wallpaper paint. He discovered the shade in 1775, and it was all the rage with the Victorians until other greens like Paris green superseded it. But this one was also made with arsenic, so it wasn't exactly an improvement. All that arsenic caused some major health problems, especially for the factory workers making the wallpaper. See, some forms of arsenic have pretty similar structures to phosphate, which is a super important molecule that your cells use to make energy. So if that phosphate gets swapped out with arsenic, your cells basically just can't make energy anymore. At a macro level, exposure to arsenic can cause skin lesions and put you at an increased risk of cancers, cardiovascular disease, diabetes, and early death. It's bad for the brain too, leading to delirium and other neurological issues. Scheele's green declined in popularity in the 1870s because they figured out that all that arsenic wasn't fantastic for you health-wise, but as it turns out, Scheele's green had a brief second life as an insecticide before being totally banned. Next up is a particularly poisonous color called manganese blue. This synthetic blue pigment is actually pretty modern. It was used between the 1930s and 1990s to color the cement at the bottom of swimming pools and in paint. It contains both barium manganate and barium sulfate. Manganese blue is created by heating up barium nitrate and potassium permanganate, which are all toxic. Barium is a heavy metal, and if even a small amount of it gets in your body, you could get a case of vomiting or diarrhea. As for the manganate part, manganate contains manganese, which is a heavy metal. And while our bodies actually do need small amounts of manganese, too much can cause cardiovascular problems. The dose makes the poison and all that. It can also cause nervous system problems that appear similar to Parkinson's disease, especially if you inhale a significant amount of it. This means the people making the actual pigment are most at risk, because they're the ones working with dangerous levels of barium and manganese. But regardless, there are much safer ways to to create your blue period paintings. Our final poisonous paint is cobalt violet, which has been in production since 1859. The very first versions of cobalt violet were made of cobalt, obviously, but they also contained our good friend arsenic. We already know what the arsenic does to you, so let's just focus on the cobalt. Like manganese, your body actually needs a little bit of cobalt. It's part of vitamin B12, which you need to make red blood cells. But if you ingest a lot of cobalt over long periods of time, you can get cobalt poisoning. See, cobalt in paint exists as an ion, kind of like calcium and magnesium ions. These ions disrupt protein synthesis, hinder the uptake of iodine in the thyroid, and impede DNA repair. Symptoms of cobalt poisoning include heart issues, deafness, nerve problems, tinnitus, and thickening of the blood, which sounds awful. Oh, and thyroid problems and vision problems too. Cobalt poisoning can also have some neurodegenerative effects, which can look kinda like Alzheimer's disease. All that said, it takes a really long time for severe cobalt poisoning to occur, so when it comes to cobalt violet paints, the arsenic would get you first. But if you're at the craft store and see cobalt violet on the shelf, don't freak out. Today, cobalt violet paint is made without arsenic, and cobalt poisoning is mainly concerned in industrial settings, so it's perfectly safe to use in your art projects. These are just a few of the ways we've accidentally made poisons when trying to make the world a prettier place. The next time you're in a museum looking at a spectacular old painting, remember, a double meaning may not be the only thing hidden in that canvas. There's probably also arsenic.